Now let's learn about image sensors. So image sensor is a device that converts an optical image into an electrical signal, and it is mostly used in digital cameras, camera modules and other imaging devices. And before the invention of these modern image sensors, as shown below, we used video camera tubes. Okay. They were based on vacuum tubes, and that was the technology used in older analog television era. Okay, so before we switched to digital cameras, so all was video tubes, and then they had analog modes of transmission, everything. Now as the technology evolved, we have modern sensors like CCD sensors, CMOS sensor, NMOS or live MOS technology. And this image illustrates how a sensor is mounted on a camera. Okay, so this is a camera mount, sensor mount. Okay, and this is how the lines are connected to the processor. So this is a and a second image. If you zoom into the sensors, and you can see the each sensing element here. So you can see red and green and blue dots here if you zoom in. Okay, so this is how the sensors are set up in a digital camera. Now important to note here is the sensors here are colorblind. They cannot see what color is falling on them. So basically they just record intensity. No matter which spectrum you put or which intensity you put, it will just record the intensity and give an output proportional to the intensity falling on it. But you need to make it sensitive to a color so that you can create color images. Okay, so for that you need to put color filters. Okay, like this. So it controls the or filters the green light, blue light or red light falling on a pixel. So we make it sensitive to a particular color, like a particular pixel or element, sensing element will be made sensitive to green, red or blue. Okay, and then we sample it and represent it so that we can view it anywhere. And and also we need to make sure that we filter the IR rays, because IRs will have a effect on the outcome. So we don't want the IR rays to be sensed by the sensors. So we need a IR blocking filter, and this is the incoming ray. So incoming ray falls on the IR filter first, and then it falls on the color filters to control which color should pass through that. And then we have the sensing elements. These are the colorblind sensing elements which is put up in the device. Okay, so this is how a typical RGB camera works. And to see the inside of a camera, this is, if you are interested, this is how it looks if you open up the all the casing and all. So it's quite compact, and it uses what is called as flexi electronics, so that you have a flexible PCB board and you can put the component so that you can reduce the overall size of the device. So this is the battery, and you can see all kind of components, the chipsets or capacitors, okay, and the wiring and the lenses and the lens and all other things, and the flash also. So this is a typical inside view of a digital camera. So let's look at aspects of image sensing. Incoming energy lands on a sensing material responsible to that type of energy, and it generates a proportional voltage. There are three principal sensor arrangements to produce electrical output, and collections of sensors are arranged to capture the images. So the three arrangements are like, you can have a single imaging sensor arrangement, or a line sensor arrangement or array sensor arrangement. So this is a single imaging sensor, and you can see it has a housing material to house the sensing material, which could be a silicone, and you need a filter to filter out unwanted radiation. Typically we use a IR filter, and then the incoming energy falls on the filter and passes through the filter and falls on the sensing material, and it gives a proportional voltage output. And you can use a single sensing element like this to capture the scenery or capture the document or something, or else you can arrange them side by side like this. You can have thousands of such sensors arranged closely packed. That is basically line of image sensors. Or else you can also have a grid like structure like this, which is called as array of image sensors. Okay, so you you may have millions of sensing elements in a half inch area. Okay, that is the level of integration we can do these days. Let's look at how we can capture the image using a single imaging sensor. So the sensor that we use is basically a photodiode, that is the most common, and it is constructed of silicon materials, and its output is proportional to the intensity of light falling on it. So you can put a additional filter in front of it to improve the selectivity. Like you want to select only a green, red, or IR, whatever kind of thing you want to make that sensor sensitive to, you can do using a filter. And to sense it, you basically have to mount that sensor in this type of arrangement. The sensor is mounted here, and it can move in horizontal direction, and the document that you want to scan is fixed on this cylinder, and it can move in vertical direction. So the relative displacements in both x and y directions between the sensor and the area to be imaged will create the output image, okay, or output representation in analog form, and you need to digitize it to get a digital image. Okay, and this capturing technique is basically you can say it is like typewriting the other way. Instead of printing, we are scanning. Okay, we are grabbing what letter is typed on that. Okay, so just think of it as the opposite of printing, scanning. Okay, next, image sensing using sensor strips and rings, you basically have thousands of sensing elements one after the other, means they are arranged in a linear way. It can be a sensor strip like this, okay, and you have a area to be imaged like this. Okay, this is the arrangement of a typical Xeroxing machine or a scanner. Okay, so here you see a scanner. So where is this? Where you can see the fast moving object inside is that line sensor, strip of sensors. And also it is used in this CT scanning device, where you have X-ray source at one side, and you have the sensing elements inside the ring. Okay, sensor ring you can see. So if you look at this zoomed in version, so this is what you have inside this, and that will capture, and that will be given to a computer to generate the image. So this is how it works out. Basically that X-ray source rotates, and it goes through the head or person or whatever object you want to scan. Okay, passes through that and falls on the sensors, and sensors give the output, and it is connected to the computer for further processing and image reconstruction. The strip basically has the imaging elements in one direction, and the motion of the document you need to scan should be in the perpendicular direction. And this type of arrangement is used in most of the flatbed scanners, like that you see in the Xerox machines or any scanning device connected to a PC. And this is a simple scanning device where the sheet is made to move, okay, rather than the sensor strip moving. This is a simple construction. And also you can have a basic, have 4000 or more inline sensors. You can have much more than that also. And they are routinely used in airborne imaging applications for area scanning or terrain mapping. So this is one illustration. You can have sensor strips below the plane, wing to wing, you can have underneath the plane, and you make the plane fly over an area to scan it. Okay, so this is how it works. You can use sensor arrays to capture images, and that is the most popular technique now, like most popular and most convenient for digital cameras and mobile cameras. Okay, typical sensor arrangement is 4000 cross 4000 element array, and CCD sensors are used widely in digital cameras and other lighting instruments. And this is a CCD sensor arrangement, okay, inside the camera. This is the actual pic, and this is the arrangement, how it looks. Okay, you have a matrix of sensor elements like this. Next part is the image sampling and quantization. A digital sensor can only measure a limited number of samples at a discrete set of energy levels. Quantization is the process of converting a continuous analog signal into a digital representation of that signal. And you can see there is a scene element which is analog basically, and you are scanning along this line, this AB line. And if you scan it, you can see this is the line we are scanning. Now you can see A is in white part, white intensity, and when you hit the scene element, the intensity drops to black or reduces to black. So A typically represented by a higher value because it's white, and the moment it hits the edge here, it the intensity falls to lower value. And as you can see, there's a reflection or something in the scene element as you move to the middle, and that is basically somewhat brighter than the edges, so the intensity increases, and again it falls off to minimum value here. Okay, at this point, this edge corresponds to this point, and then there is a sudden switch over to white part, and suddenly the intensity jumps to here, and we can scan till B, and this is the intensity map. Now this is the analog output of that particular line scan. Now we need to digitize it. So first thing is we need to take samples at particular intervals and encode those samples with a intensity level. So in this example, we are having samples here. We are taking samples at these intervals and we are mapping the intensities to 8 levels. Okay, so pitch black to full white and gray in between in progressive way, and 8 level means we can represent the image in 3 bits per pixel. So if you do that, the output will be like this. Okay, so this is the digitized image having its level. So for this A, you A at that particular sample, you have a particular level. It could be a higher value 111 maximum, and this could be lower, this is 001. Okay, so like that, this is how we digitize the image. And always we need to remember that digitization is an approximation of real world scene. It can never be exact replica, because if you zoom into the final level, you will see the pixelation happening no matter what kind of or how many bits you use. At the finest edges, you will see the pixelation or the square edges happening. Okay, so that one thing we need to remember all the time. Let us now look at the simple image formation model. So binary image, that means images are having only two possible brightness levels. It could be either pitch black or full white, nothing in between. And for those kind of images, you just need 1 bit per pixel representation. That's more than enough. So 0 means black and 1 means white. Second type is the grayscale image, or we call it as black and white in general sense, black and white television. So it's basically grayscale image. So grayscale means the black is 0, white is 255, and anything in between is the value in between 0 and 255 for general representation. Or if you normalize the pixel values, 0 is black, 1 is white, and 0.1, 0.2, 0.3, 0.9, all this will represent gray levels. And another thing is color images. It can be described mathematically as three grayscale images. So if you embed a red, green and blue, stack them together, you will get a full color image. And if you take particular hue like red, and if you view, that will be a grayscale image. Only when you merge them together, you will get full color images. Okay, we'll illustrate it later. Let f of xy be an image function, then f of xy is I of xy into r of xy, where I of xy is the illumination function and r of xy is the reflection function. And we need to note here that illumination function varies from 0 to infinity, and the reflection can take the value between 0 and 1. Okay, so reflection only between 0 and 1, and illumination between 0 and infinity. And for digital images, the minimum gray level is usually 0. We peg black at 0, pitch black at 0. But the maximum depends on the number of quantization levels that we use to digitize an image. In the previous example, we used 3 bits per pixel. That means we had only 8 levels. If you put 8 bits, it will be 256 levels. Like the most common is 256 levels, so that the maximum level is 255. So 0 to 255, you'll get 256 levels. That is the most common format that we use. And this is how we represent a image. If you view it in three dimensions, okay, this is three-dimensional representation. This is the top view, and this is the actual picture pixel value. Now look at it closely. So this image, as we can see, the letter D is marked in full white, and it is surrounded by the light gray area, and the border is pitch black. Right. Okay. Now if you analyze the pixel values here, it's basically 0 corresponds to black, and gray level a value in between, which is 0.5 here, and white is 1. So we are having a normalized image here. Normalized means you just divide the maximum value by 255 if it is grayscale, or whatever maximum value is there, you divide any pixel value by maximum value, and you will get the normalized value. That means you will get the range between 0 and 1. So letter D, which is in white, will have value as 1. Now if you view it in three dimensions, so D, which is white, will have higher amplitude like this, and the gray scale in between will be mid level like this, and the border black like this. Okay, yeah, so this is how we can represent the image.